type of crop which are grown here, domination of commercial crop since very long time, rubber, spices, plantations, of course coconut, rice is reduced to very low area. So while rest of India is now talking of high level of commercialization in agriculture, I think Kerala agriculture was commercialized to, I would say, very large extent long back. And sometime back in March, I was asked to deliver a lecture in Mahatma Gandhi University in Kottayam related to WTO issues for agriculture in Kerala. And from the question I gathered that the issues for Kerala agriculture, be it marketing, be it WTO, be it any other thing, are totally different than the issue which we see in Delhi for major states or major agriculture. Nevertheless, I feel that there are some general aspects, there are some common aspects which apply both to Kerala agriculture and also to agriculture. Also, I need to say that the time has come when we should look at agriculture now differently. The first speaker also mentioned about the share of agriculture in GDP, all those kind of things. I think one cannot realize the importance of agriculture correctly if we look at this number, what is share of agriculture in GDP. Because that follows a particular definition and that is meant for a particular purpose. It is okay for accounting purpose that share of agriculture in GDP is 14%. But if agriculture is not there, then much of the rest of the GDP will not be there. For example, we have a speaker from food sector. So whatever value addition they do in food sector is not possible if food is not there, but it is not counted in the food sector. It will be counted in the marketing or in the food processing. So there is much larger segment of GDP which is not possible if primary production is not there. And when we calculate the share of agriculture in GDP, then we look at mainly up to a point when the produce changes its form. Beyond that, we say that it ceases to be counted in agriculture, it gets counted elsewhere, like textile industry. So if cotton is not there, there cannot be textile industry. So output of textile industry will not be counted or attributed to agriculture. But you can imagine that if cotton is not there, then rest of the 5% or 8% of GDP will not be there. That is the reason that even country like USA, where agriculture and food economy direct contribution is less than 2%, less than 1.5%. But you look at their debate in parliament and other things, how much time agriculture occupies, because it matters not only as a food for survival, but also for much of the food processing industry in USA and like that. So with this background, I come to the topic which is assigned to me by the organizers to speak on agriculture markets. Those of you who are interested, they may take copy of my paper from the organizer, and it is also published last year in Economic and Political Weekly, where I talk about development policies and agriculture markets. I would like to begin with this agriculture market, that some people look at role of agriculture markets from a very narrow perspective. For them, agriculture market is merely taking produce from farm to fork, or taking produce from, say, farmers to the end users. They may be consumer, they may be industrialist, or whatever. This is a very narrow definition. In fact, there is a larger role of agriculture market which goes like this, that agriculture markets not only ensure that produce is taken from farm to fork, farm to kitchen, or farm to our stomach or to industry, but agriculture market also plays another 3-4 important role. And one such role is that it must transmit macroeconomic signal for a resource allocation. Now what does it mean? Since many of you are not economists, what does it mean? What it means is that market must give signal to producer where they should allocate their land, where they should put their fertilizer, where they should allocate their capital investment like that. To elaborate it further, that if market is not distorted, then it will give the signal automatically. Should Vidarbha be growing sugarcane, then water table is going down. Should Punjab put 80% of the kharif area under paddy, then it gets very less rainfall, and which is resulting in 5 feet decline in its groundwater tables. So if there are no distortion by policy, you will find that market will give this signal to Vidarbha farmers, reduce area under sugarcane. Market will give signal to Punjab farmers, don't put so much area under paddy, reduce it. Don't grow the paddy the way you are growing, grow it in a different way. Don't grow it in standing water, try to work out another method of cultivation of rice. So that is important role which market give, that a farmer should be having what kind of optimum cropping pattern. The cropping pattern which is consistent with ecology, with natural resource endowments. And this signal will come if we are not distorting input price, if we are not distorting output price. A very big role, and right now my center, where I worked till recently, still I'm associated with that center, is doing a study that if we do not intervene through policies, then what is the best cropping pattern for major production system in the country? This is very important role of the markets. That should Kerala really be going to this extent for this spice crop, rubber, or those kind of things? If we take into account what is the environmental effect, effect on natural resources, biodiversity and like that. So market has mechanism to at least give signal based on monetized aspects of economy. Then role of policy comes to look at those aspects which are not monetized but factor in those kind of things. The second role of market, of course, that to promote welfare of producers and consumers, and they are the main. Somebody is either a producer or a consumer, so to promote welfare of these two stakeholders and promote efficient use of resources. Does it make a sense to use 5,000 liters of water to produce 1 kg of rice? Does it make a sense that you use 5,000 liters of water to have a net earning only of 5 rupees or 6 rupees? Water will fetch you much more if you supply water, 5,000 liters of water to other users and other users. So if we have not distorted power structure, water pricing, or output pricing, the market will give this signal that what is the efficient use of resources. Also, market contribute, has the potential to contribute to economic growth. I will share some statistics with you that what is the potential of agriculture markets to contribute to India's economic growth. And it also helps in achieving social goals like poverty reduction, inclusive growth and sustainability. So you can have market policy which help in achieving those kind of things. Then this role change over time depending on what type of agriculture production we have. This role is not static, and this role changes mainly on account of two factors. One is that demand changes. Second is that opportunity changes. One can say also challenge, etc., but I am just putting that these are the two major drivers for looking at changing role of agriculture market. So what is happening to demand side factor in India? If you look at how much consumers were spending or what percent of their total food expenditure they were spending on processed food 5 years back, 10 years back, 15 years back, so you just find that the share of consumer expenditure on food which goes for processed food, that is rising. Are our markets changing according to this? The answer is no. The answer is no on several counts. That if you look at that 10 years back, if you visit some person in North India, the chances were 90% that you will be offered only tea. And maybe 5 years back, the chances were that 80% chances you will be offered tea and 8% chances you will be offered aerated drink. But if you visit now, then I would say that chances are only 60% that you will be offered tea and chances are 30% that you will be offered juice or something like that. And preference is rising toward those kind of things. But are we producing our food, are we producing those kind of juices, processed food, according to the demand? The answer is no. In India, the growth of processed food industry is declining. It is positive, but it is declining, decelerating. Whereas growth rate in demand is increasing. So as a result, what is happening? The concentrate will come outdated, date expired from USA, elsewhere, Brazil, and they will make some mix out of it, pack it in, I will not name it, some beautiful renowned brand, and that will go to houses as if they are taking it as a fresh juice. So consumer believe he is taking a fresh juice, whereas in fact it is not. Why it is not? That because in India, we did not allow our market to get linked with the producer, to produce the type of produce which is appropriate for processing. And therefore, the demand and supply imbalance is there, and lot of import of processed food is taking place. We are also exporting a lot of horticulture product, but even the import of horticulture product is rising every year by 15 to 20%. So, because demand is shifting toward this. So this is another reason that we need to change our system of marketing so that consumers are able to get processed food to the extent their preference is there for it. Then farm fresh produce, again in India, the demand pattern is shifting such that people want to consume summer vegetable in winter, they want to consume winter vegetable in summer. So throughout the year they want to have it. Earlier, particularly in North India, carrot, turnip were never consumed in winter. But now household want that at least some carrot, some turnip should be there. Similarly, peas were not to be seen in summer. But now consumer want that peas should be available in summer also. So preference of consumer to have fresh fruit, fresh vegetable throughout the year. Another is that quality food, quality consciousness. Another is safe food. And these are very important areas, safe food. The other day I asked this question to a DG of FAO when he said in the world the hunger is declining. So I told him that today India and many other countries, they are not facing so much a problem of adequate food, but they are facing serious problem of availability of safe food. So today a consumer is afraid, I don't know, maybe Kerala situation is different, in Delhi, the vegetable which I am buying looks so fresh. Is it really fresh or it is made to look fresh through spray of some hormone, freshener? Is it that there is no hormone? I as a consumer feel concerned, the chicken which I am eating, the broiler has really grown in a natural way where it was made to grow through some chemical and like that. So in future, particularly in a country like India, the food safety issue will assume, already it has started assuming, much higher, not like Western 3500 calories, this thing and that thing. We eat small portions, but we want that well to do, and some even, though not so well to do, but still their preference that they want to have organic food, they want to have particular nutrition. Those who are having diabetes, they would like to have dicocum wheat rather than ordinary wheat because dicocum wheat contains much less particular attributes. And these days many people talk of role of food as a food plus. That you can keep good health, you need not visit your doctor if you can get a particular type of food. So those are the kind of things which are happening in the food and in the grand country. And those things are possible only to do which our marketing system needs to address. Another reason for change in market to my mind is trend toward bios. Everything you find that ladies, they would prefer biocosmetics rather than chemical cosmetics, biomedicines, biopesticides, bioenergy, So in everything, this bio content, and even in the industry, you look at US industry, that how industrial ink is getting replaced by some ink which is made from some vegetative product like that. So industry preference is also shifting from synthetic and chemical. General trend toward bio in consumption, toiletries, all those things. So this is happening. And these things also necessitate that we now need to look at our agriculture marketing system afresh. Grading in the farm itself, according to quality, according to size, according to appearance, all those things. Rather than this traditional method that farmer has grown 10 bags of onion, in bulk he bring, it is purchased and bulk comes and bulk goes, not much of the valuation taking place. Another reason that we need to pay attention to marketing is that scope for post-harvest value addition is now much more than what is value addition in production. If a farmer produces 1 kg rice, the net value addition may be 12 rupees. But after it is sold in the market, you will find that value addition is much more than 12 rupees. And our farmer's farm size getting smaller and smaller, the opportunity to raise income from harvest getting shrinking, becoming less and less. The only way to raise income of farmer is if you can make him a partner in the value addition. That in the value addition, the rice paddy which sold at 12 rupee a kg, in terms of rice 80 rupee a kg, later on sells at 40 rupee a kg. So you look at the value addition after harvest and value addition before harvest. So can we equip our farmer, Mr. Ramesh from the top of farm producer organization, can we empower them to just earn a part of that post-harvest so that income of the farmer producer also keep increasing. Then traditional markets, they are not able to meet the changing demand, and this necessitates that we need to evolve our market. We need to give different orientation to our agriculture markets. Also, new opportunities for commerce, e-marketing, all those things, they are emerging, and we are not, paying attention to these things. Many people in metropolis, maybe in Kochi, want to have some fresh produce, vegetable produced in the countryside near Kochi, 80 kilometer or 100 kilometer. Do we have arrangement for those kind of things? Do we have this mechanism that, okay, for farmer we have set up some of the places in the town where they can bring their fresh produce and sell it? And you will be surprised that if you look at Western country, this trend towards fresh produce is rising so much that in Norway they encourage vegetable carts, that those farmers who want to bring their vegetable and sell it in the cart, the way in India it is happening, but fresh vegetable. They are encouraged, they are given all sort of incentive. Similarly, if you buy any fresh produce these days, these farmer market in many towns in USA, you will find that consumer will go all the way to that farmer market and pay many times more than what is the price of vegetable in the supermarket. But they are going for it. So those kind of things, again in India, whether we can also have this kind of thing rather than having remaining laggard and doing things after many, many long years. Then our agriculture market, unfortunately, are not at all moving in this direction, and there are reasons for it, that we are just focusing on price, not thinking much beyond price, not bringing right kind of reform in agriculture markets, and our policies are becoming more and more price-centric rather than development-centric. And not enough time to elaborate many of the things, but to make the long story short, that if you look at government of India or for many states, that what is the present policy on marketing. So that policy tried to satisfy three groups. It's not looking at what kind of demand is emerging, what consumer is looking, what are the opportunity to put growth dynamism in the sector. They are just trying to satisfy or pacify three groups. One is the group of producers, so they are kept happy. With this promise, we are giving MSP and we are giving big raise to MSP. whether farmer get that MSP or not, nobody is bothered about it. But every time news will come, this time Commission for Agriculture cost and prices, they have given so much rise to prices. And I don't know why farmers feel happy that rise in MSP has been given, even though nobody would buy rice at MSP in major states except 5-6 states. But still, I think that illusion has worked very nicely. So this is one thing, that you are keeping policies, keeping producer happy by saying that we are giving you minimum support price and we are giving big rise to minimum support price. Then on the other hand, consumer, we are just telling them that we are keeping you happy, we are giving you food subsidy. That grain which cost 40 rupee or 30 rupee, we are just giving you for 3 rupee and 4 rupee. So don't make noise, be content with this because we are giving you a lot of food subsidy. And then there is another class which has emerged after early 90s, that middleman, traders, all those things. So we are keeping them also happy that we are not allowing competition into market. We are not letting modern capital come into markets. So you also be happy because we are not letting any reform come into the markets. So the policy is now stuck in satisfying these triangle, producer, consumer and vested interest within them. And we are not really moving toward real development of markets. This is the main crux of this market. So, what is the consequence when you have this this policy of satisfying the interest group? The development perspective in agriculture markets is lost. This has stopped progress of market reform and intensified center states. Those states will say, we told center that minimum support price for paddy should not be 1200, it should be 1800, but center is not giving. Then center will say, we have told states that we will share with you under market intervention scheme, you give some price support for plantation crop, everything, whatever. We will take 50% cost, rest 50% you bear, but states are not doing it. So rather than improving the market, rather than bringing competition which will automatically ensure that there is a remunerative price, so this blame game is rampant. Then since all the stakeholders have also realized that approach is now price centric, so they are building more and more pressure on prices, that we should be given higher price, we should be given MSP for everything like that. So the emphasis is becoming price centric, that give us more MSP. Demand is coming, give us MSP for milk, give us MSP for all sort of crops. So what is this MSP doing? What good it is doing and what bad it is doing. MSP is windfall for some, but it is a double whammy for others. You will be surprised that MSP is working to the disadvantage of some farmer also. And I have written on it, one can read it, that how it is. One thing about MSP is that though we are announcing MSP for 26 commodities, actually MSP is enforced only for 4 commodities. It is wheat, paddy, cotton and sugarcane. Other than these 4 crops, there is no effective MSP, because if you want to give MSP, if you are announcing MSP to ensure that farmer get that price, there should be some mechanism. The mechanism that we use in India is procurement, and you know that government cannot procure everything everywhere. So where you are not procuring, and if MSP is higher than normal price, you will find that farm harvest price will be lower than the minimum support price. However, as I mentioned, that this illusion has worked very well, and it has windfall gain for some commodity, for other it has been costly. Because in one of my papers, I demonstrated that higher the deviation between what will be the actual market price if there is no intervention by anyone, and if MSP is higher than that, then it will go to the advantage of those producers from where government is buying, and it will go to the disadvantage of those producers from whom government is not buying. Because if suppose open market price of rice, paddy will be 1200 and government give 1300. Now much larger quantity will come into government hand and much smaller quantity will be left in the markets. The private player will do this calculation that since government has purchased much more than what it need for public distribution system, so after some time government will be forced to release this quantity in the market under OMSS, open market sale services. So they start offering lower price to the farmer because they know that subsequently government will be forced to release their stock in the market, and they found it much more pain to buy from the government than to buy from the farmers. So they keep lower price for the farmer because they know they can buy at a lower rate from the government. So you will just find that in many cases MSP goes to the benefit of those farmers from whom government is buying, and often it goes to the disadvantage of those farmers from where MSP is not enforced. So it works that way. That's why I just called it double whammy. Then I also demonstrated that there is evidence that in the absence of strong competition, this traditional capital converts small decline in production to violent fluctuation, particularly in the case of cash crops, onion, etc. Now, what is the current status of agriculture market? You know that in 1960s, 1970s, we brought lot of reform in agriculture market. In fact, then also agriculture market were in shambles, lot of exploitation by private players of the producers. So that time there was need to bring this regulation, there was need to bring market under a particular regulation. So all regulated markets, they adopted a particular act. Lot of things have been written about this APMC Act. In early 19, the need was felt that now we need to liberalize markets because markets have reached a stage. We cannot go back to the old stage that even standard weights were not there, standard measures were not there. So therefore, and so many things happened because the rest of the economy we were liberalizing. So need was felt that we need to liberalize our agriculture markets, and we did it. That in 2002, Essential Commodity Act was removed and private sector entered into agriculture market in a big way. 10 big companies entered into India's market, including some foreign companies, Stadium Beet Board, Cargill, our own that Britannia Limited, all those 10 big companies entered into agriculture markets. And 2003, 4 and 5 were the only years when beet in UP sold at a price higher than MSP. 20 years before that and 10 years after that, beet in UP market never sold at MSP. It always sells at a price lower than MSP. But those were the only 3 years when private actor sector entered into a big way, lot of competition into markets. So you just found that the producer were getting price higher than MSP. Similar thing was applying to paddy and rice in West Bengal. I gave example of these two states because UP is largest producer of wheat and West Bengal is largest producer of paddy rice. But then what happened that in 2006 there was this global food crisis, and because of global food crisis, international prices were rising very high, and we also mismanaged our grain, and when there was this 2002 severe drought and like that, then suddenly wheat crisis came in India. Then India wanted to buy wheat from international market, and international prices because of global food crisis were more than double. So then our bureaucracy used this argument that because we liberalized our market in 2002, that's why all this problem has arisen. That's why we are not able to buy wheat in all those things. Again, they rolled back those reforms, and after that 10 years, say 6-7 years have passed, we are back to where we were before 2002, and that competition which came, particularly in grain market, for a brief period of 3 years, that opportunity was lost, we did not recover it. And as a result, because of this so-called APMC Act and government intervention, where we stand, you just find, you look at competition, that there is a big competition in mandi. I used to call that India's agriculture markets are crowded. There are small players. They want to make good profit even on 500 bag, 1000 bag. Scale factor is not there. This is one example I have given that how much agriculture market are crowded. That in the state of Punjab, there is one commission agent for 50 farmers. Imagine. just for 50 farmer bulk commission agent. And you know that bulk commission agent has to make at least 5-6 lakh rupee net income, and that he will make out of produce of only 50 farmers. So how he will play in the market, raising prices, charging much higher commission, playing with the so many kind of things. And the so-called pro-farmer states never entered into reform because they know it. The moment we would like to introduce reform, the other party which is supporting us will withdraw this court and our government will collapse. So what they are doing is that in this state, similar thing may be there elsewhere also, that the commission agent, what role he is playing, he is taking check from Food Corporation of India and passing on that check to the farmer. And in this process, he is just charging 2.5% of the value of the produce, just for taking the check and passing it on to the farmers. So FCI thought of that, why not to make direct payment to the farmer? After all, we are buying wheat, he is selling, so we give check to the farmer for the amount of wheat. The chief minister of the state came 3 times to Delhi to request the prime minister not to enforce the direct payment to the farmer. So what I am trying to say is that political class is not supporting the reform in the agriculture market. If they are not supporting this reform in the market, and if they are more concerned about middlemen, their profit, all those things, then you will find that producer will not get better price, and as a result, lot of price spread and things like that will happen. And many places, studies show that there are informal cartel of unorganized players, that they are called unorganized, but to protect their interest, they are very nicely organized. Scale factor is not there. Large number of transactions are there, that between a farmer and a consumer, we did a study, we found that on an average there are 6 transactions. So you know, for every transaction that there is an intermediary. So you can imagine that normally this process can be reduced to 3 transactions. Scale will bring its own kind of things. Similarly, if you look at the infrastructure, that over time the growth in infrastructure is not keeping pace with growth in the marketed surplus. And though we say that we have organized our markets, so this data I collected from government sources, that in 36% of the markets, even the pakka common auction platform is not there. You look at the facilities which are there, right? Drying yard is there only in 26% of the market. Grading equipment is there only in 30% of the market. Drinking water tap is not there in 70% of the market. So when these facilities are not there, farmer will be forced to take obligation of some of the shopkeeper there, sit there, and forced to sell his produce through particular kind of RTA or commission agent and like that. So but a poor state of market infrastructure, that this is one area where government was supposed to make investment, and they are collecting a lot of revenue but not re-plowing it. And you find that in many of the commodities, I just took this example, that sometimes we talk of that there is a disconnect between consumer and producers. And this is the evidence, that I will not call it disconnect, I will say there is a peak connect. That last 10-12 years, because India has shortage of pulses, so I look at what is the rate of inflation in pulse prices at different levels. Producer level, the prices increased only by 4.6%. And minimum support price increased only by 6%, and wholesale price of dal increasing by 11% every year for 10 years. So the producer prices are not rising even at half of the rate at which the wholesale and retail prices are rising. So but consumer is paying, not even half of it is getting passed on to retailer or to the producer. Producer prices are also rising, but the rate of increase is not even half of what is the rate of increase in wholesale price and retail price. So it again speaks that so much need for market reforms. There were other things. I think you can see these things in my paper, or you can have a copy of this presentation. I will just quickly come to 2-3 important points. Now, since FICCI is organizing this, co-organizing for this workshop or seminar, I would like to share with the participants that what are the opportunities in agriculture market and in agriculture trade. This is the calculation I did to give some idea about how much volume of business is there in agriculture. Out of 240 million ton of cereal produced in the country, 183 million ton enter into market. Rest get consumed, self-consumption, use as seed, use as feed, little bit wastage. So you look at the quantity, that 183 million ton, 10 million equal to 1 crore. So 18 crore ton of cereal is transacted. 17 crore, 1.7 crore ton of pulses are transacted. 3 crore ton of oil seed is transacted. So you just look at that, this is the base which is available to the business if appropriate market conditions are created. And in terms of value, that this is the value at the farm level, the value of the crop which enter into market, either reduce that component which is retained by the farmer. This is value of the produce which is disposed at farm level. Nearly 10 lakh crore is the value of the produce which enter into market. So if there is a value addition, if there are supply chain, all those things, so you look at the base on which this business can be developed. 10 lakh crore rupee is the base business in crop sector alone. Then look at livestock, 4 lakh crore rupee in fishery, and this volume rises 2 to 3 times in the marketing. So subsequently it rises 2 to 3 times. And who is benefiting out of it? At whose cost that benefit takes place? I think these are the points which we need to ponder before we just come to that what kind of markets are there. We need to look at these dimensions, that how much business is there. So what is the way forward? Having said that this is the status, these are the problems, this is the way we need to go, this is what our consumer wants. I would strongly say that we need to shift our policy focus from price-centric approach to development-centric approach. That price-centric approach is needed for food staple, for some stability, but it is not a panacea, it is not a solution to all the problem. Therefore, we should need to do alternative things, and we have developed some mechanisms, made some suggestions that how MSP should be enforced. It should not be through procurement. There are alternative ways, deficiency price payment, price insurance, those are the kind of things which should be used rather than physically procuring much more than what is required for this public distribution system and stability. And I also compared that MSP versus competitive markets. If a farmer get MSP, it is stable, but generally prices are low. If it is a competitive market, the prices are fluctuating, but average is higher. That is what we have seen in most of the commodities. Another disadvantage of MSP is that it destroys the entrepreneurial skill of producers. This is what has happened in those states where MSP has been coming for a long time. 2-3 years back, Union government wanted to come with a diversification package for states of Punjab, Haryana, Western UP. So they asked me also to prepare a package, and I took them to some of the farmers. If you tell to the farmer in Haryana, Punjab, UP, that you, Western UP, that you go for alternative pulse or oil seed, his first question will be, will government buy it? Then I told those farmers, if government will buy everything, then where is your entrepreneurship about which you used to feel proud? We are great Punjab entrepreneurial farmers. So I told them, for me, a producer of apple in Kinnaur district is much more enterprising than you, because while sitting in Kinnaur, he makes phone call to Delhi markets at what rate apple is selling, what price will be there after 10 days or so. If I send a truck today, is it okay? What kind of price is it? He do that market intelligence. That is entrepreneurship. So because a stable price and fixed price was granted, and because of that, marketing skill of farmer has been completely killed in those states. No way to take market risk or to try market opportunities. Whereas competitive market offer opportunity to risk-loving producers, that if you have some love, of course, I know there are risks associated with it and how they can be taken care. Also, MSP is anti-diversification, that if consumer wants, like in India, per capita consumption of cereal is declining. But still, the maximum emphasis is on raising production of cereals. You see, government doesn't have place to keep. But still, more emphasis on this, because system of MSP is operating, market signal are not getting transmitted. So MSP is anti-diversification, whereas competitive market is diversification friendly. And MSP does not address these MLS, whereas competitive market you produce, because ultimately what should be produced, only that should be produced which is to be consumed. It is the consumption which should decide what should be produced. It is not the production which should decide what should be consumed. So reverse thing is happening because of this excessive emphasis on MSP in some of these states. Also, MSP is desirable when markets are missing, but competition is always desirable. It is sustainable. It has some kind of things. So with this, these are the 10 bullets which I say that there are alternative to MSP. We need MSP, but we need it in a different way. And for rest of the produce, we need to work out to system of deficiency price payment, price insurance, and like that. And our experience of last 10 years show that there are many crops where MSP is not there. They have grown at a much higher rate than what is the rate of growth and output of those crops where there is MSP. Cotton is different story because BT role is there, BT came, technological component is also there. But wheat and rice, where MSP is most effective compared to all those crops, the growth rate is not even 2%. With great support, we are ensuring growth rate of 2%. But vegetable, fruits, milk, egg, the growth rate is more than 4%. And there is no MSP for it. So this is another important lesson. And another I would like to say that we need to attract modern capital in all sphere of marketing. We need to promote market-friendly institution, infrastructure, regulation. Already something is happening, like farm producers organization, producers companies, NABARD and Small Farm Agri Business Consortium. They are emerging it, hand-holding all those things. The other day I was talking to that chairman and MD of Small Farm Agri Business Corporation. So he told me that with the help of NABARD, they are able to form 700 producing companies. It's a good beginning, but I told him, what is the 700 for India? We have how many villages? 5 lakh villages. At least in every village, you require 2-3 producer companies. So with the 700 number, it will take you centuries to cover entire country. So we need to do certain things as a mission on bar footing. If we want really that there are producer companies, we give them bargaining power and all those kind of things. And I would also say that I am not against public sector, I am votary of public sector, but to do specific thing. Public sector we require for stabilization. But if we want higher profitability and all those kind of things, those are possible only through competition. If there are more and more players in the market, more new kind of investment is there in the markets. So we need to change our APMC Act, and our markets will not evolve if regulation is preventing evolution. Right now it is happening that regulation itself is preventing evolution. Even if we just implement APMC Act in its true spirit, still proactive policy will be required, because on its own it takes much longer for market to evolve. So we need to have policies which favor that evolution of market, consistent with what are the changes in market, consistent with what are the opportunities, consistent with what kind of e-commerce is there in agriculture. So at last I would say that India needs healthy competition in the agriculture market. We require public sector, also private sector. They have different purpose. I always give example of telecom sector, that we have MTNL, we have BSNL, we have private companies also. If we leave it completely to public sector, you know the kind of situation which we had. Similarly, if we leave it totally to private sector, then we also know that what will be the consequences. So we need both these sectors, but rather than driving one away, they should work alongside, they should coexist, they should compete with each other, and they will perform their respective role. Public sector for stability, for insurance, for safety, and private sector for competition, for value addition, scale advantage. Thank you very much.